Okay, so let's go ahead. So there are some things that are so big that may have implications for every one of us. So big data is one of it. And big data is transforming the way we do so many things, the way we do business, the way we use data to make business decisions, the way we use data to inform ourselves about our everyday life, our everyday activity. So the world now is make decisions based on data. So gone are the days whereby people just make random decisions. Now, serious businesses, economies, serious countries, they now make decisions solely on data. Yeah. So what's the next thing? So the basic idea behind the phrase big data is that everything we do now is leaving a digital trace, as they do say. So do you believe that everything you do now is leaving a digital trace? Yeah. And that digital trace nowadays is actually data. And these are what formed what is known as big data. So your interaction with everyday devices, social media platform, even your mobile phone, yes, all those things, your interaction with all those things leaves a digital trace of data. So there's an aspect called human computer interaction. So every day you interact with computer, every day. Even your phone is like a mini computer in your pocket or in your purse. And you interact with your phone every day. There was a research that I was going through. There's a research that I was going through, and the study said that we look at our phone at least 7 times in 3 minutes is it 3 minutes? Okay, I think 7 times in maybe something around 10 to 15 minutes, we look at our phone 7 times on the average. So can you see the level of your interaction with your phone? So all these things, and whenever you interact with your phone, it's either you are on social media, you are making some posts, or you are posting some pictures on your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, all those things constitutes what is now known as big data. And you are still going to see as we go ahead. So from the dawn of civilization until now, humankind has generated 5 exabytes of data. Now we produce 5 exabytes every 2 days, and the pace is what is accelerating. Okay, so this pace at which we generate data because of our interaction with computer devices, because the pace at which we interact with those technologies has also increased. So that has also made the amount of data generated from such interaction to also increase. So let's look at some activities that could lead to generation of this big data that we have been talking about. So we have simple activities like you listening to a music. Maybe you use a music app like Spotify, or you watch Netflix movies, or let's say your smartphones, your web browser, or even your credit card or your ATM card, or even your location at every point. All these things are activities that generate data. So all these things are activities that generate what is known as big data. Now, I had an experience of this. Like 2 weeks ago, I went to a store here. So on coming back, I noticed that Google is actually tracking all my locations. Even though it has asked me before that, I think it gave me a notification that my geolocation is on and all my locations are being tracked. But I didn't really give a damn to it until later on. I just came back from a store like 2 weeks ago. Then I saw that actually saw where Google have been recording all the locations I've visited since January. And I was like amazed, you know. I was so amazed. So then, you know, if, for example, if a person gets lost now, those places he has visited in the past, if the person has turned on location tracking, so that means a person, people could track all the places that person has visited over the past weeks, and that could actually help them in their investigation of looking for that lost person. So all these things are data that make up what is known as big data. Even your phones, you have your call logs there, your call logs are there. And when we say data, we are not only referring to figures, as in even your pictures, your browsing history on your web browser, all those things constitute what is known as this big data. So let's go ahead and see more. So what about conversation data? It all started with emails, but nowadays we have conversations going on social media. Even our phone conversations are now digitally recorded. So all those pictures that you send on WhatsApp, all those voice messages, everything all together, they are the data that we are talking about. So these are conversational data. And the beautiful thing about data science or artificial intelligence is that nowadays we have tools, processes, machine learning algorithms that can analyze different varieties of this big data, be it posts, social media posts, be it even image. So we have image recognition, we have face recognition, we have voice recognition now. Think of it, in any form the data is, there's a machine learning application now that can actually analyze it and draw out useful insight from there. So if we could analyze your phone conversation, we could gain insight into the kind of person that you are. if we could analyze even your email messages, we could gain insight into what your activities are being, who you are, what you are thinking about, you know, so many things, even from your social media posts. And that's why when you go on Facebook, what do you see there? You see, what are you thinking? What do you wish to say or something like that? Or what are you thinking of? So as you leave out all those posts, as you leave those posts, then we can analyze it and gain much more insights about you. So let's go ahead. So what about photo and video? Yeah, so these are also data, as I told you earlier. So we have CCTV cameras that takes video messages. Then we ourselves will upload hundreds of thousands of videos on YouTube and other social media sites, okay? So even the ones taken by your smartphones or digital cameras, all these are also data, okay? So like currently now I'm working on image processing, and we're actually working on some digital cameras images, and we're applying some machine learning algorithms on them, like the KNN, that's K-nearest neighbor. So all these are the data that we are talking about. What about sensor data? So sensor data are what is now responsible for what is known as smart cities, smart homes. And sensor can be installed on CCTVs, even homes, offices, even your mobile phones has a sensor called the GPS. Okay, so all these things are to track your location, they are to track your direction, like the Google Map. And we now have sensors in many devices and products, and the purpose of that, to those sensors, is actually to generate real-time data, okay? To generate real-time data that we can make use of and they form part of this big data. So let's continue. So when you have sensor, you can easily harvest data from there. And the magnitude of data that sensor generates alone, it is so massive. So when we harvest data from any kind of sensor, then, you know, there's a lot that we can now analyze. What about IoT, Internet of Things? So we now have smart TVs that are able to collect and process data in real time. So then one interesting thing is traffic sensors on the road that can send data to your alarm clock, which wake you up earlier than planned whenever the road is blocked. Okay, like in Abuja now, if we have traffic sensor there, data can be harvested from those traffic sensor. Then we can apply some machine learning techniques on those data, and it could actually help us to predict the traffic jam on any given day. Yeah, so I'm one of the person that have been looking around the streets. Whenever I'm passing through the streets in Abuja, I always imagine I could do a machine learning project that uses traffic data. Yeah, so I've once imagined it before, passing through the streets in Abuja, even in Lagos too. So, but as of now, I don't know any traffic data in Abuja or Lagos. But if you know, then this could be an S to do some kind of traffic predictions. Okay, so all this constitutes data, and when they are well used, then it makes life much more easy for people. So they are called Internet of Things. So they can be used to power like smart cities, whereby you already know there will be traffic jam before you go out. You don't need to run into any unforeseen things. You can use it to track criminal activities and all those stuff. So they are called Internet of Things. So now let's look at the four V's of data. So Clara, when she defined what big data is, she defined it in terms of the volume, but it's not about just the volume. We also have the velocity, then we have the variety, then we have the veracity. So these are the four V's of what characterize a big data. Now, as a data scientist, you need to be able to identify them when you see them and to be able to harness them for your organization or for your tasks. And these are the four things that you're going to look out for. So we have the volume there. So let's first look at the volume. So vast amounts of data are now being generated every second. We're not just talking about terabytes now, but we also have zettabytes or even brontobytes, okay? So data is generated in the world, beginning of time, even until now. So now the most interesting thing is that we also have big data tools now that can effectively analyze those big data, okay? So that is it about the volume. Then let's look at the velocity. So the velocity aspect of it is the speed at which those data are being generated and the speed at which they moves around. Okay, so think about social media messages that goes viral within seconds, or technologies that allow us to analyze data in real time. Okay, then what about the 5G that is also coming up, that is going to power up a lot of this Internet of Things that we have been talking about? So like some few days ago also, I was researching and reading into as in doing a research on 5G and about the speed at which it's going to deliver to us what we need on the internet. And you could be amazed that why the 4G that we are using now could take up to like, let's say, could take up to like could take up to like 10 minutes, you know, to download a 1 gig, let's say a 1 gig video. So 10 minutes, that is if you are in a place where the internet is good, where the 4G is very good. I know that in Nigeria, even to download a 1 gig video, 10 minutes may not be realistic. But let's assume in a normal place at a normal speed of 4G, then you should be able to download it in like 10 minutes or so. So But for the 5G, you can actually download that same video in less than 1 minute. So you can download a 1G video as a 1 gig video in less than 1 minute on a 5G network. And 5G is going to be what is actually going to take the world to a new level, in that most of the technologies that is being rolled out or rolled out now, like the driverless cars, for instance, for a driverless cars, it needs a constant stream of data, runs through the streets and is powered by data, real time. So a driverless car cannot operate on an intermittent, on a braking network, or what we called the latent speed. So the latent speed is not, it requires a network with a very high latent speed, with a low latency. Low latency. So it requires a network with a very low latency. That means a network that is very fast, the velocity is so high, the speed is so high, and that is what a driverless car needs. And that is exactly what 5G offers. So it's going to be a revolution indeed. It's going to change a lot of things. And even here in the UK, there are some places now which already have the 5G, and so many technological companies are actually waiting for the massive rollout of it, because most of the new age technology now, they need a network with a very low latency, and the velocity should be very high, and that is what 5G is all about. Okay. So we also have the variety. So varieties, just as I said, we have text, images, video, voice. So all these constitute big data. Okay. So varieties. We have them both in structured form and unstructured form. Okay, so like text messages, video, and voice, those ones are unstructured data, and they constitute 80% of the world's data. So that means we have more of this unstructured one more than the structured one. Then, what about veracity? So this refers to the messiness or trustworthiness of data. So every forms of big data comes with a challenge, and the challenge that we have is that they come in a very unstructured form. They come in a very messy form. They are not clean, and we have to do a lot of data cleaning on them. Imagine you want to analyze voice messages now. That means you have to do a lot of pre-processing on the voice in order to extract the useful things from there. And even if you want to process image now, there are some techniques that we use in processing image for analysis. And you have to do a lot of color correction. You have to do a lot of gradients reduction. You have to do you have to do what we call color histogram, and a lot of things has to be done there. Okay, so and if you are also analyzing like Twitter posts now or hashtags, abbreviations, they can come with typos or colloquial speech that you may need to extract out so that you can get the useful things from those texts. So like this year now, we'll be embarking on a kind of natural language processing, which is also an aspect of artificial intelligence. and we are going to be analyzing so many texts, and part of it is the Twitter posts. We are going to be mining various sources and online, and we are going to be dealing majorly with texts, and we are going to be applying some data analysis techniques on it, because we are going to be working on a project. I believe the new research intern in the house, Clara and Solomon, so I'll still get back to you on this. That is actually what will constitute a major part of your work as we work together. So these are one of the area also of big data, okay? So let's move on. So how do we turn data into big data into value? Okay, so the datafication of our world gives us unprecedented amounts of data in terms of volume, velocity, variety, and veracity. And we are to harness these things. We are to leverage on them in order to gain insights and add value. So these are some of the distributions of our, okay. So we have different types of datafication in our world now. We have activities, conversation, words, voice, social media, sensor, video, photos, as we said, and they are characterized by these four things, which we just so now: volume, velocity, veracity, veracity. So in analyzing them, there are different techniques that we use. We have the sentiment analysis, which is majorly used for analyzing text. We have the face recognition, which is majorly used for analyzing images, under which we also have computer vision. Then we have the voice analytics. That one is used for voice, for analyzing audio. Then we have the movement analytics. That is, then we have so many of them also, okay? So many areas. Of course, machine learning too is there. Natural language processing, robotics, drones, and so many other things are also involved. And the purpose of all this analysis of big data is actually to what? Gain what? Value. So that is the end goal. So anything you are doing in data science, the end product should be to gain value, to add value, to improve processes or operations, to generate insight, to solve a problem. So that is the end goal of every data analytics, okay? All right, so let's move on and see the various areas. So how is big data actually used? One of the areas of use is in business. So we can use it to understand and target customers, and we can do marketing analytics. Telecom companies or all kinds of companies can use it to predict customer churn. Retailers can leverage on it to create what is known as predictive models to predict how much they are going to sell. Car insurance companies or consumer companies can actually use it to understand their customer well. So when you're acting as a business consultant for a company, the company may be interested in understanding their sales, forecasting their sales. They may be interested in knowing how much customers will buy. They may be interested in knowing how much of their customers will default on loan like banks now. So all these things can leverage or models that have been trained with this big data, and they can actually be made to predict or give a prediction on all these things. So even in Data Lab as we are, we do make use of marketing data a lot. And when I say marketing data, I don't mean just gathering people's name and all those things. No, I mean real-time analysis of web data, what we call web analytics, whereby I know where you click, I know where last you browse the websites, I know what you checked, I know what you may likely subscribe to, or I know if you will later come and join our internship in a matter of weeks or months. So some of you might have been here in Data Lab because of some of these marketing analytics that we did. So we don't need to walk around the street. We don't need to come to your house to tell you about our program. We don't need to give you flyer. I don't know when last time we even printed a flyer. So we don't use all those things again. So we don't need to walk around the streets in the sun, as some people or some marketers do. So we don't need all those things. If we have your data, if we have the data, then we could actually leverage on it and reach you where you are in your house without necessarily coming to knock at your door or meeting you on the streets. So these are some of the areas that big data can be applied to. So in the course of your internship, for those of you that are already in the program, you will also work on some project that has to do with application to business. Another area is to optimize business processes. So big data is increasingly used to optimize business processes. So retailers can leverage on it to make a predictive model to predict their stock. We have web search trends, which we use so much in Data Lab. We have the weather forecasts. So these are ways you can use this big data to optimize your business, to optimize your sales, to optimize your marketing efforts. And every company wants to sell. Every company wants to make profits. And when they employ you, or when you are like a business consultant to them, then you must find every ways how to leverage on the data that they have in order to increase their sales. So when you train as a data scientist, all this gives you the tools and the knowledge to go about that. Then we also have improving health. So the computing power of big data enable us to find new cures and better understand and predict disease patterns. Okay, like we have the coronavirus now. So many studies have been done on the application of machine learning to understand and predict the spread of COVID-19. And some few days ago also, I did a literature review on so many of those applications. Okay, so you see different machine learning models that people have used to predict epidemics and disease outbreaks. And one of the areas I love working on in data science is actually applying data science to health. So I've done some machine learning projects on that. And so I have a flair for application of machine learning or data science to health. Okay. So of course, when you are into data science, you may pick a very good you may pick an area where you are mostly interested in, like application of data science to sports, to health, to education, to the environments, just name it. So you're always free to apply it to any of these areas. Okay, so one of it is health now. So let's move ahead and see. So then we can also apply it to improving security and law enforcement. So we can leverage on big data to foil terrorist plots and detect cyber attacks. Okay, so nowadays, some of these modern technologies are being poisoned with cyber attacks. Okay, so that falls under another arts field called cyber security. So, of course, cyber security also depends on data, because without data, how can you track terrorists? How can you track cyber criminals? So actually, big data makes it possible to track all these things. And now what we are actually talking about is AI. Nowadays in the world now, we talk about some AI applications that some people gain entrance into them and poison them. So, and when they poison them, they start to they can turn them against the people, something like drones now. So some few days ago, I was also discussing drones with some set of people here, and one of our fears with drones, because they want to be using drones to take network communications to rural areas now here in the UK. So of course they have network in rural areas, but they want to use drones to further optimize it. And those drones, they are going to be suspended in the sky. Drones fly, so they are going to be suspended in the sky, and that is how they will be. So they will just be in the sky, and they would have been fitted with some network stuffs, and they can broadcast 5G even to villages and stuffs like that. But one fear about it is that cyber criminals can probably poison those drones and launch them against the people down there. So that is one of the areas of concern. So then we also have credit card fraud. So banks use this a lot, and presently, even in Nigeria, fintech companies and banks, they are the highest employers of data scientists as far as Nigeria is concerned. So if you are looking into working in data science as quick as possible, then you can look into fintech companies. So many of them are in Lagos, like Paystack and all of them like that. So they are the highest employers of data scientists in Nigeria. Okay, so we also have improving sports performance. So we can use big data to improve sports performance. So many sports equipment now are now fitted with sensors. that generates sports data in real time. And we have even some wearable watches that tracks nutrition, sleeps, social media conversations to emotional well-being. Now, I have a problem with this social media conversation. And though they also constitute one of the big data, but there's this issue of data privacy now that is also a big thing now that is militating against further development of big data, or that is one of the areas confronting artificial intelligence and data science, the issue of data privacy, especially in countries like Europe and America. Data privacy is not much a thing in Africa yet, but over in Europe is a big thing that, if not properly checked, could actually land a company in jail. So, and what data privacy is that you must declare how you use people's data, how you must not store people's data beyond a certain number of days and stuff like that. So where, as time goes on, this thing will also still come to Africa with time. So though some of this technology can track people's personal lives, but now they are being questioned because of the issue of data privacy. Now, even the Google that is tracking my location, I've turned it off some few days ago. I decided to turn it off because I don't want Google to track my location again, and I have the right to do that. Yeah, so that is data privacy. So, but this is sports now, and we can leverage it in sport. So we also have improving and optimizing cities and countries. So you've heard about smart cities, smart towns, you know, where we have a bus could wait for a delay train, where we have automatic traffic signals or traffic signals that predict traffic volumes and minimize jams. So these are what makes everyday commutes around the city to be with ease. So, and all these are only possible if we have an historic data to predict on, or we have a real-time flow of data in order to be able to tell a traffic light that switch on, switch off, you know, like that, in order to minimize traffic jams. Okay, so currently we are only seeing the beginnings of a transformation into big data economy. So now we call this economy big data economy. And any business that doesn't seriously consider the implication of big data runs the risk of being left behind. Yeah, so any company that want to matter in this end time or in this present time, then you have to make use of the data. You have to harness the data at your disposal. You have to build your products using data. You have to build your service using data. So gone are the days whereby a company will just make a product without caring who, if people will buy, how much people will buy, and all those things. It's very risky to do that now because people are more complicated now than ever before. And the only way you can understand people's behavior, their motives, their intents, is actually if you could have access to their data. Yeah, so I also spoke about the issue of data privacy, which as a data scientist, you should also be aware of the implication of data privacy. Then also as a data scientist, of course, you should also know where to get data, what are the sources of data. So if you are given a project now, where can you find the data? Where can you mine the data from? And we also looked at the various sources of data that we have, which constitute the big data. We have the social media, which is one of the big data source. We have like Facebook, Twitter, and all those social media platforms that constitute or that can give us the data that we need. And of course, devices too are there, mobile apps, even your phone logs and stuff like that. They also constitute that. And several things around our cities and towns generates data in real time that now we use now in data science. So that is why data science is gaining ground now, because virtually everything now is being powered by data. And I can tell you that truly data is the next big thing. Yeah. Okay, so this brings us to the end of this presentation, and I'm sure now you know what big data is and what are the various uses, how you can leverage on it. So when you are coming into data science, you're actually coming to learn all these things and how you can use it to add value to whatever you are doing. If you're employed in a company, then you should start thinking about how you can leverage their data in order to increase their products, their service, their value, you know. So this is what you should be thinking about. And that is why they employed you as a data scientist. Yeah. Okay, and most of the time, they are not going to know where to get them from. So you as a data scientist, you are the one who know where to get those data from. You are the one who will advise them on what to do. You are the one who is going to classify this data into their different categories, like text data, voice data, you know, numeric data, you know. So you are the one to classify them, okay, and you are the one to decide which machine learning model to use in order to mine those state data and gain insights through them to uncover patterns in them. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this seminar, and I'll be willing to take your questions now. So if you have any question, you can speak up, or if you don't want to speak up, then you can drop a comment in the comments section there. Yeah. I'm good.